All right, welcome everyone to this live force premium workshop drawing event, right? Force Friday. So anyway, this Force Friday, what we're doing is we're gonna try to reveal the secret, right? The whole point of being here today is to figure out what the answer is to the secret to dramatically improving your drawing skill. And there actually is a secret. I'm not BSing here. there is an answer that I want to share with you that I very, very strongly believe in, that I want you to, you know, to just be aware of, right? Super, super important. I'm going to show you a lot of different examples of work to provide some support to this answer. And as always, you know, I want you guys to, you know, ask as many questions as you like in the chat so we can hopefully make this as educational and as entertaining as possible, right? So as always, before we get started, I want to say hello to Swenly. How you doing?
Yeah, good. And I was just thinking maybe it's worth mentioning that because of, how do you guys call it, daylight saving time, that...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, for some people, it might be a different time than usual.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you for bringing it up. So yeah, here in the US, we moved an hour forward, right? So from here on out, all the way until around October, I think it is, end of October-ish or so, beginning of November, we'll be on this new time slot. If you're in another country, that doesn't change time zones, right? Or daylight savings or, you know, or not. How's it going, Mrtunjay?
Yep, it's going good. We are just revealing the role, secret role.
Yes, the secret answer to life, right? So, you know, like I was saying before, this is a pretty big deal. In mentorships, I'm recognizing also how much this changes, how well someone draws, and also how fast that change actually occurs. Yeah, it affects the speed with which you change your ability also. So let's just get to it, right? We have an hour, and I know, as always, that hour moves by very, very quickly, right? So let's get back to Photoshop. So what is the secret, right, to dramatically improve your drawing? Well, I grabbed a whole bunch of portraits to just start conversation around this, okay? I figured let me grab like a subject matter, a thing that a lot of artists work on, and take a look at them, you know. It's like, and this is open for conversation with Swenly and Mrtunjay, so, you know, I want all three of us talking on this, and for you guys out there that are watching today and are in the live chat, you know, so what's going on here, right? Like, I guess my first question here would be like, what's the difference between these two pieces, right? Like, what do we see here? What's the visual difference, right? You guys have any thoughts, Swenly and Mrtunjay? There's no right or wrong here. I'm just going to keep guiding, so nothing to be worried about.
I guess like the second one is, you know, they're both like amazing pieces. Like, you know, it's obviously like very, very good. The second one is like more like, it has like a lot of energy in like every brush stroke. So it overall kind of gives like an overall motion. It's like the hair doesn't like, feel like it's not stiff. It's like, oh, she's like moving like this, and the hair is like bouncing around. It, because of that energy in every brushstroke that the artist gave, I think, you know, that is a little bit more expressive. And if I would like painting that model, I would just like go with my like this approach on the right. So mm-hmm. Yeah, but they're obviously like both are very, very good, like very masterful. So
yeah, a lot of skill in both of them, right? There's no question about that. Ditya Jaswal said, yeah, there's realistic, right? We have realistic and we have abstract, right? A little abstract. And that is a great analysis. I would agree with you. We have super high realism on the left. I mean, it is not far from being a photo. If I shrunk this down and this wasn't a drawing workshop, somebody just looking at this would think it's a picture, right? It looks like a photo, right? Super photo realism. You know, we can zoom in on this, right? And it's like, look at like the thinness of the brush strokes that had to have been made to paint this hair and make it look like this hair. And all the eyelashes, the drop shadow of the eyelashes, the accuracy of nuance in her teeth and her mouth, the wrinkle in her skin, right? The wrinkles on her neck, right? It's very real. It is extremely real. It's very well done. This person can see extremely well, right? Anyone who has this capacity to photorealism, I think, sees very clearly, right? You have to see very clearly, I think, to get to this place. Now, what I don't know where this started. I don't know if it was projected, you know, onto a canvas and then therefore traced, so they got all the stuff blocked out. I don't know if they actually drew it from the ground up. It doesn't matter almost either way, because in the bottom line, the finished presentation here is of an extremely highly skilled photorealistic painter, right? Really well done. I don't know this artist's name. I do know the artist on the right is an artist named Skip Lipke. Here, I'll write the name down in case you guys like this style. Lipke was big when I was in school. I was a student, and you know, so he's probably 10 years older than me or so, and he was a pretty young guy, I remember at the time. But you can see his name here, but it's spelled I-L-E, I think, Lipke. I think it's like this. And his first name was Skip Lipke. So I would see his paintings in downtown New York in the gallery sections and seen originals of his, which I just thought were amazing. This, again, and anything I say here, I'll try to be clear on when is my opinion versus the conversation. I just happen to love this kind of stuff. I love when art looks like art, you know, like an artist's touch is there, versus the photorealism is so damn good that I can't even see how it was made. Right. It's that good. Right. For what it is. Right. It's that good. Where in Skip's, to what Mertunjay was saying, there's an aliveness that comes to it because you're seeing the activity of the artists make strokes. Right. So the strokes bring activity. You can see, you know, we zoom in here. You know, I loved always looking at the way he drew the structure and the highlights. And he always put this tint of red in the noses that I really, really loved. You know, it's almost edible. it looks like cookie dough to me. You know, like it's got this thing and this texture to it that almost looks edible. It's that good, right? And here, you know, I love this. I love this arm. It's like you can almost feel the volume of the arm because there's parts of it that are transparent and yet it has this solidity where it gets more opaque in the paint and then he sticks a highlight on it. I feel like I can go up the tube of her arm with my hand, right? Like you can see the thinking that went on in there, right, to create that volume, right? It's very, very interesting on like what's happening there, right? All right, let's see.
That's a good point that you reinforced, Mike. I think the second one takes more thinking than the first one. Like the first one is based a lot of on observation, like how well you can see, and the second one takes more thought to simplify and abstract, you know, what you see.
Yeah, there's a, yeah, what you see, right? There is a level of the abstract, like you said. There's, you can almost say that one on the right is an artist's impression, literally, of this reality. And the artist on the left is saying, like, this is reality. This is how I see. And they see like a camera, right? They see the clarity of truth, right, to things. We know that the one on the left, it looks real. I see her. I could see her. I see her as real in my world, right? And it's kind of a style thing always. Now, it's interesting when you look at artists that do something like the one on the right, it's like, well, that doesn't look real. She probably doesn't look like that. There's no one walking around the planet that looks like an oil painting, right? It's an artist. It takes an artist's mind to go through that subtle abstraction to say, here's what matters to me, right? I don't care, you know, Lipke doesn't care about getting to here, right? This is what I care about. There's a certain richness in the skin that I want and certain colors maybe I even like. Her skin, I don't know, her skin tone might not even be exactly this, right? But there's things that he's trying. I think he tried to capture the paleness of her face floating in the black hair. Like that's a decision, you know? He could easily went there and moved her hair and told her to sit a different way. Like he probably prepped it. He's like certain things he's looking for. So he's already affected reality. And then he's abstracting from that reality too, right? So let's look at the next one, right? So this is Lucian Freud, who's, again, personally, I happen to love his work. They have some pieces of his at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. Yeah, it's funny. I'm kind of like on the fence about his drawings, but his paintings I think are spectacular. They, to me, they're very real. Like I see, you know, going back to our realist, I know that I see the world like that, but when I look closer into the world, I actually see more like this. What does that mean? Well, when I look and I'm looking from a painter's eye and painter's standpoint, I start to see all this like nuance of color. Look at how much green and orange and dark red and blue are in the skin here, right? All these like variations in color, right? He's excellent at that. And yet the structure, you know, if you squint your eyes and you look at this image, it actually starts to look like a photograph. You know, you drop off all the nuance of his brush strokes and detail. And the value there is correct for the shadows, the drop shadows, shadow on the face, the light to dark within all these undulations of different colors. It's just fantastic. You know, it's he's a very well-known artist and rightfully so in the world. And it's just spectacular, right? Just amazing work. I mean, I love the highlights. It's just so much like real skin, right? And by the way, this is something I learned when I was in school. Freshman year, you know, we learned to like see better and see it like this. You almost actually go beyond here. Now, it's not like this doesn't have undulation in it. It does, but it's different. It's almost in a weird way, more polished, right? It's almost like more polished to perfection to get it to look like this photograph than this does, right? This is a cruder take on reality, but I know I can see this, like I can see like this. I totally understand Lucian Freud's mind and his vision. Like I can step into that and go, yep, I've seen that. I painted before. I know what this guy's doing. I get that space, right? Then there's these. So the left one is one of my favorites. As you know, this is actually a self-portrait of Frank Frazetta, right? We talked about Frazetta quite a bit. Look, it's interesting, right? It's not photoreal. It's kind of impressionistic. It also has a sense of drama, which Frazetta has always had. Even in his own portrait, it feels heroic. He feels like a hero to me in this painting. It's a very heroic portrait, right? Very different than on the right, we have Egon Schiele, right? So not heroic at all, more of a quirky introvert, right? Kind of interesting, right? Totally different take on these two different people. But to go back to what we were talking about before, it's like getting into the head of the artist, you know, and this is the thing that this will lead us to as to what the answer is here for today. But these drawings, these paintings, they look very different, right? The approach is very different. Like what's going on here? How did Frazetta get to this place with his self-portrait and Egon get to this place? I mean, you look at Egon Schiele and we go back here, right? Wow, look at the difference here. Look at Schiele versus the photo real image. That now we're talking about, man, we're really increasing the separation, the delta between those two artists. How does that happen, right? What is going on there? So different. All right, let's go quickly to the chat. Let's see. Mystery. Malcolm Lipke. Yes, Malcolm is Skip. That's right. So Mars was asking, his real name is Malcolm, but he would go by Skip for like decades. I feel like there's some story in the second one. I like to be somewhat stylized or might as well do photography. I think it's good to learn rendering though, but to produce more stuff that looks like art. Yep. I second that. Welcome. The second secret to improving your drawing. Cool. This is interesting. Inside mind of the, yes, inside mind of the artist, right? It's kind of where we're slowly starting to walk our way here, right? What is the inside mind? You know, I think it's really beneficial for you guys to be aware of that. You know, don't purely look at art and say, I love it or I don't like it, you know, or I hate it or whatever. But to analyze, you know, and look, and man, if you can do it, it is so powerful to try to get into the mind of the artist. You know, what did it take to get here? And I don't mean the skills. I mean, the vision, right? The vision in this, the vision difference between Frank and Egon, right? Like, how does this happen? you would think we're all human and we should all really just get to this, right? I mean, we all probably see more this way, right? Even if we don't know it, even if we don't recognize it, right? If you're not an artist, you still, hopefully you see like this, you know, you have this some sense of clarity of the person that you're looking at. Yet we go all the way up here and we're really getting abstract, right? I keep pushing us further and further and further. Egon's getting pretty darn abstract. You know, we know it's a guy, we see hands, we see a face, right? But pretty abstract, right? Which leads us to this, right? Now, I didn't do this on purpose, but look at even just Malcolm or Skip compared to Picasso, right? Whoa, now what happened, right? What's going on here? How did we get here? Now, some of you may not be aware of this, but Picasso can paint realistically, as photoreal as anything else here, by the way, okay? He has the capacity to do it. What leads an artist here? You know, is it madness? Like, what is it? Right? How do we get here? Why is he making these decisions? Right? It's interesting things to think about. You know, when you go to museums or even you're just looking online, it's like, how'd they get here? Why are they doing this? Right? Why are they doing this? I love that. I love that conversation. I love that thought of what's going on over here. Do I see like this? Can I get into this headspace? Right? Can I wrap my head around the Picasso piece? When I was in school, you know, in college, I didn't like Picasso because I thought he's just a hack, right? Like, what is this guy doing? Here I was like struggling to get to realism. And I was like, why is this guy so famous? Look what he's doing. Like, I could have done that in high school. Like, and I'm in college and this is nothing, you know, but you learn, there's way more going on here. And as I may have told you guys, I was in Barcelona 2 summers ago and there's a Picasso museum there. And I was blown away by where he was at 14, 15 years old and his painting skill, his drawing skill. And he didn't start doing this, by the way, until he was around my age. So he was in realism up until around 50 when he started pushing more into this space, right? So much later in life did he come to say, this is how I see things. I'm going to finally put out my opinion on my perception of things and what I care about, what I don't care about, right? That suddenly starts to make things very different from this. Right? Very, very different. Very different goal, right? Extremely different goals going on here from Picasso to the realist photograph, right? So let's keep moving. So that leads me to this. I'm kind of putting those two bookends together now. On the left, we have a pencil rendered portrait of Jack Nicholson, right? And on the right is an artist named Kruger. I happen to have a book of his, so I know how his name is spelled. I'll write that down for you guys. Brush here. It's K-R-U with the umlaut for German, right? Kruger. So Kruger was an extremely famous caricaturist and illustrator. And I have to say, man, he is damn impressive. And not because of the caricature, but if you see his other artwork, he can go from this image on the left. This isn't his on the left, but he can do that totally hyper photorealism, but also bring the photorealism to a caricature, and he can go abstract, right? That to me, I'm like, that's exciting to me. The fact that somebody has that range, right? I think there's something to be said about that. In my world, in my opinion, I think somebody said this earlier, I think it's great to know that you can render from photorealism, that you can see that clearly. There's a truth there. And how far down the rabbit hole of truth can you get, right? That you can see that clearly and mimic the rendering of reality and even the color of reality. So grayscale and tone, right? And the color of reality. But go beyond reality, that your skill is good enough, that you have an idea and you can present an idea. It is not easy to do that, okay? I respect all caricaturists on the planet Earth. I've been there, I've done it. It's a job to be able to look at someone and have a response, a conceptual response, and then be able to actually have the skill to bring that idea to fruition. It is very different than copying a photograph and trying to get its measurements right and trying to get its grayscale right. That is a very different mindset, extremely, extremely different mindsets. And it's kind of where I want to start leading this conversation. I want you to be aware of that very different headspace, right? To have an idea over here and execute on it and bring it to reality, right? From your brain to reality versus looking at something and copying it and see if you can replicate or mimic the reality. Two very different things, okay? All right, let's see. I'm going to jump real quick here. Joe says, reality, what we feel, what we create between the model and the artist, but not to be confused with, say, smudging or artifice. We live in a photo world, so to speak, but what is important is deeper. Yes, I would agree. Yeah, that's really interesting. I'm trying to figure out that balance out for myself, my own art. Wow, it's extreme exaggeration. Yeah, so look at this. I have one more Kruger piece just to prove my point about abstraction. So Kruger is here on the right, this caricature. And then look at this piece by him. Here, I'll put this over here so we can just do a side by side. All right. So look at that abstraction. Look at how crazy he's getting. I mean, this mouth is unhinged. It's totally unreal. Like this would never exist in the real world. Not like the other one would either. But this is really far-fetched. And yet, you know, it's Nicholson. That's insane, right? The fact that it's like, how far can I go with my concept where the judgment call on what would make it bad, right, would break it, is that you don't know who it is anymore, right? Like the goal of the caricature is to go, I still know who that is, and I can't believe he drew only three lines on the piece of paper, right? Like imagine that. So look at how far Kruger pushed this image, but there's the iconic shades and the forehead and the grinning mouth, the cigarette, the attitude, right? The personality and attitude in this painting by Kruger to get us to this image of Nicholson, I think is astounding. You know, amazing, right? And I would say that's how Picasso started getting to where he is going, you know, where he went, I should say, right? Is to keep pushing this abstraction to try to get to these simplifications to the core of an idea. And I think, in my opinion, I think that's very different than this image on the left. Is it done well? I think it's done extremely well. Is it skilled? I think it's extremely skilled. But the idea is just to show you, look, I've got to this photorealistic level and you could take a photograph of it. It's so good. It's like a photo. So to me, these are artists who really push into the craft of copying realism, which is no easy task. I don't want to disrespect it. I want you to understand. I think that's amazing. But that is a very different mental job than doing this, right? Very, very different mental job. For me, again, personally, in my opinion, I actually do prefer this, you know, and I always have, by the way, even while in art school. I'm much more blown away by the creative, artistic aspect of how do I push this somewhere with my idea than to just photorealistically render. Now, to make this point, let me show you something else. This is a piece of art from the same student. Okay, this is someone who sent in their work to me, who's a new premium member at drawingforce.com. And they showed me their rendered work and their drawing work. Okay, this is why I say drawing and rendering are two very different things. It's one of my pet peeves. One of my pet peeves is someone calling a rendering and a drawing the same thing. They are two different things. To me, drawing is line and rendering is shading. Right? Shading and tone. You're playing with tonal value. You can combine the two. This one, I would say on the left, doesn't really have much drawing in it. It's pretty much tone. There's no line or edges in there, right? It's value changes. And the subtlety of value changes bring us to a place of realism, right? Because realistically, with our eyes and the way we see the world, we don't really see lines. I look around my living room here and I see shapes and I see values, right? I see light and shadow. My brain has to go into drawing mode to go, okay, I see those shapes as lines now. I'm turning things into lines, right? But really, I see the way this artist sees on the left. But what's amazing here is that that artist on the left is the same artist as what's on the right. So I'm going to say here, I'm going to put a daring note out here, and I'm going to say, I think drawing is harder than rendering, right? And I think the proof is right here. Why is that? Well, the first reason is, on the left, this pose, and I'm not totally going to be correct about this, but I'm going to kind of sum it up. the pose on the left to create that rendering took weeks. I remember the students saying it was like 3 or 4 classes a week at 6 hours a class, and it took weeks and weeks. I think I remember calculating it was something like 30 to 50 hours to create this piece on the left. Okay. So you have time, right? You got time on your side. So with time, you know, you can keep fixing and getting the accuracy and very gently sitting there rubbing the side of a graphite, and you're checking values, right? You're constantly checking values, but you know, you get the proportion and stuff down first, right? And then you're filling it with value changes, basically, right? It's really about value, right? On the right, man, you're stuck with line, okay? It's very simple. I think Mertunjay or Swenley said this earlier, you know, it's the, I think Swenley mentioned the simplicity actually makes the job a lot more difficult, right? Line is a language, right? Just like German or Spanish, Italian is English, right? It's a language, right? So you have to like learn this language. And I think it's a tougher language actually to learn than rendering is, you know? Now also on the left, what's the goal? The goal is to replicate reality as exactly as I can. I personally don't think that's as hard as it is to draw. It takes time, I'll give it that. I've been there, I have done this, by the way. I've done this in school, rendering like this. It takes a lot of time, but it's nowhere near as hard. You know, I was in sophomore year of school. I remember one of the first things we had to do was render eggs in a blanket, white eggs in a white blanket, right? Because it was a grayscale challenge, right? And I have it, it's still hanging in my parents' house. And I still walk by it when I'm at their house and I'm like, oh, that's kind of cool. I do know how to render. I forgot that I had to do that. But it was sophomore year of school. It took me years and years and years to get to the place to learn how to draw and show you the stuff that I teach you here, much longer, right? I had barely any practice in rendering at all. And I was in this class and boom, rendered this thing out. Very different mindset. Now, for some people, it is tougher than others to render and even to see that clearly. I do think it's important. I think you need to know how to see, right? That goes for all artists. I think you need some degree of honesty, right? Of seeing the truth. I don't know if it has to go to 100% of that photorealism, but man, you got to see to some degree. If you don't see, then you're stuck right there. Then you're stuck with drawing just from imagination. And not that that's impossible, but that's a hard road. I think we learn faster by being able to decrypt reality, right? To learn from that and then move through drawing that way, okay? Okay, so I hope this shocks you as much as it shocked me, because this actually really blew my mind. I was like, damn, this really proves the point that I've been standing on now for 20 years. And here it is with one student, right? That's amazing to me. So be aware of that, okay? So that kind of leads me to some of the stuff I'm doing in mentorship. This is one of my students in mentorship. I have the students draw lots of heads. Some of the colleges do this as well, lots of Disney heads. So look at this head on the right, right? Here we have, this is drawing number 57, head 57 for her, okay? If you look at the drawing on the right, you know, we have this 3D model, but it's still, even though it's 3D, you know, it looks pretty simple, it's pretty clean. Now, if it was even a 2D animated drawing, right, from an animated film, it would have these clean, simple shapes. And what this student's learning is look at how much work is actually in there, right? The 3D program is doing the work in this case. You have to decipher in the language of drawing, right? It's a different mindset, okay? You're learning how to draw. You got to think like a drawer now. We need to figure out how lines are going to transcribe form, force, and shape, right? Not in that order, but these three ideas, right? And see the structure. Now I can tell you, she's been doing this for the last few weeks and her figure drawings that just came in were kind of mind-blowing. Like all of a sudden, this really clicked for her and she was able to bring this concept of translation over to her figure drawing and everything became way more solid, right? All of a sudden there's volume and form in the work, you see? So these are two examples. You can see it's 57 and drawing 53 I grabbed. Notice it took her 40 minutes to draw this. So rushing isn't always a secret either, you know? Sometimes you gotta take your time. Now this was from a student who, by the way, when I met her, had like no patience at all. Okay. And she would tell you that none at all, really tough. I wouldn't say patience, but lack of focus. Okay. So it now she's learned to have more focus, I think, honestly, because of her enjoyment and appreciation of doing the work and seeing the improvement, right? There's nothing better than you seeing yourself get better. It's like, oh my God, this is amazing. I can see my drawings improving. That just makes you want, you know, it's an addiction, right? Like you just want to go do it more and more and more. It's a great addiction, right? You're improving. And for her, that started happening. And now it's showing up in her figure drawing, right? Here's another, right? So this is from one of my students earlier today. This is me drawing on the bottom left. And I just wanted to show her, it's not only form and shape, it's force as well, right? Now, I've been doing these quite a bit with students I mentor this week, meaning drawing from Disney drawings and then redrawing them. It is not easy. It's pretty damn hard, actually. And the switch I made to make it easier for myself is I brought into my force world. If I drew this horse from a place of rhythm and fluidity and expression in that abstraction, and then allowed that to start to present the structure and forms and shapes, that all of a sudden started working for me. When I came in and I just tried to shape it out and get the structure, I could feel my brain slide into copy land. You know, all of a sudden I was going down into copying instead of recreating this drawing to almost the point where it feels like it's my drawing, right? That's that reference, but it's almost like the reference never existed. And it starts feeling like I'm drawing this horse. Here it is, right? Like I really get it. I understand what it took to get to that end goal, right? That's how you study, by the way, right? We've talked about Gibson and Frazetta and so on. We, you know, Leyendecker, some of my faves. Man, the way to study something is to really like redraw it, refigure it out. So it feels like it's yours. It's not even the artist's anymore. And you really get into their head because of that, right? All right, let's take a quick look over here at notes again from you guys before I move forward. Van Gogh, seriously, yes, you're right. He was older as well, very much. I hope we go into this because I know we focus mainly on line with force, but rendering could be necessary for style. Yep, totally. Rendering can be important for direct. Rendering can have opinion, I guess, to sort of requote subcons here. You can have opinion with rendering. And I think the best painters actually do that. They will cheat reality with their opinion to make it better, right? Make it even better. Okay, as far as a join, let's see. So it's not about copying, but being analytical to really immerse yourself in the subject. Yes. So it is. You want to understand, right? Copying is copying. Go and try it, right? If you go copy something, pay attention to your internal dialogue. What are you thinking about when you copy? You think, ah, that line's not in the right place. The angle's here. I got to shift this, make this bigger, make this smaller. The tone here is lighter. It's darker. Ah, the color needs to be this or this. You're basically matching, right? Matching, 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 matching. Just constantly going back and forth, and it's a matching game, right? That's it. It is honestly like really it. Maybe some of the guys who are better, like the guy we showed today, I would love to think that artist is thinking this hair is curly and thin, and maybe even going into like, what's this texture feel like, right? There might be a matching of texture to have that thought. That's cool, right? It's a little deeper, right? Like how far can you go down the rabbit hole of copying, right? But what I'm getting at, which finally brings us to the answer to our question today, right? So the question today was, what is the secret to dramatically improve your drawing, right? What is the secret? The secret is, with all this art that we looked at today, the secret is basically, what are you thinking about, right? You get what you think, or as I've been saying on drawingforest.com now for almost 5 years, your drawings are only as good as your ideas, okay? Your drawings are only as good as your ideas. That's the end of it, right? What you saw here today with all the different artists we looked at was everyone had different ideas, right? Their brain is running the show, and it's what you think is what you get. What do you put your focus on? What are your thoughts on that thing that you're focusing on? That's how your work emerges, right? That's how it appears. It's how it comes into reality, is based on your thought, right? So to come back to, this is Force Friday. Obviously what we teach is we do not want you copying. We want you to look and find force. Get your mind in a force headspace. What does force look like? How do I think about force? What are the questions that I ask myself? It comes down to your mind, okay? So this sheet that you see here, right? This is one of my mentored students. One of the things I have students do is I have them write, right? And I have them do a creative writing and I have them do a utilitarian writing, basically. I usually chart it out like this, right? So we say over here, there's the creative aspect and there's a utility aspect. And on the creative side, right, there's lots of different things this can be and go beyond even what I write here today. But I typically talk about character. Maybe you see the model and think of the model as a character. He looks like Igor or Frankenstein. She's a pirate on a ship, right, out in the middle of the ocean, getting attacked by a giant squid, right, whatever it may be. But you then have a big idea, right? So when you're drawing, you're like, I need to get that pirate feel. Why did you even think that in the first place, right? Be aware. It's like, why did my brain come up with pirate, right? So it could be character. I, ironically, usually lean very much so towards metaphors. Now, before I leave character, you know how important this is, right? This character piece. So many of you that are watching and so many on the website want to go into the entertainment industry. So think about how important this is, right? I'm trying to get you out of not only just seeing the model, but that you understand that posture and mannerism create character. That's how powerful it is. When you go to the movies, you know, and you see people not only in costumes, but they're posing and acting in certain ways, it connects, like it all comes together. You know who Captain America is, you know how he acts, you know how Daredevil acts, right? You know how Wanda acts, right? We all watched WandaVision, I'm sure, over the last few months. Or the Vision, right? They're different people, different characters, different roles. Their postures and mannerisms are different from one another. So you want to learn that. Here's a chance to learn that. You can look at the models and actually go, oh, what kind of character is standing here? And why do I think that? How do I hold on to that idea? It's like caricature that we saw with the portraits today. I have an idea. I'm going to bring that idea over, not copy, because you're not going to get it. I can promise you, you actually will not get the spirit, right, of that pose by purely doing a copy. It becomes somehow dead. This is talking from experience. I've been there. You can copy it. It's not the same thing. It's just not, you know, you have to understand what you're after, right? And you're drawing your thought, what you are after, right? So for me, it's not only character, metaphor is a really big one. We've talked about this a little bit in the past. I like natural disasters, not real ones, of course, but I use them as like, I like things with a lot of force that are big, right? So tornadoes, right? Like the, you know, the model's like a tornado twisting and turning, because I think of the models as huge. It over dramatizes the power in their body for me. I want that drama, right? The metaphor might be functional. We talked about this too in the past. We talked about like construction equipment, or maybe it's like a mixer. Maybe this thing reminds me of a column or a fork, whatever it might be, right? Some kind of functional thing. The more functional it is, the more force-driven and functional the metaphor, the better, right? So you got metaphors and character. And on the other side, you got utility, right? And the short of utility is you want the verbs first and then the nouns. So the thing to really swallow here is, and this, man, every time I say this, this sounds like, I don't know, like weird philosophy or something, but you're drawing what the model is doing. And as you draw the doing, the model appears, okay? Not the other way around. You don't draw the model and then try to push into that what they are doing. Draw the doing. That is the force, right? Those are the forces, the rhythms in the body. Obviously, you're going to start drawing the body because you're drawing those rhythms, and the rhythms are of the body. But instead of focusing on the body and putting your brain there, you want to put the focus on what is the body doing? I see the force of the back, right? Ah, let me start drawing that force of what? Of the back. Of course, the back's going to show up, but it's very different to say that than to go, let me draw the model's back. It might as well be a rock, right? It's not the same thing, right? You got to get your mind into the place of I'm drawing these actions and these things will appear, okay? Okay, so you can see here, this student had, this student loves fantasy. So this is like whole stepping back from the swipe of an orc sword. And then also we have this utility stuff here, leaning back, squared, spreading, bent, bracing, stabilizing, hanging, sweeping, centered and lifted. See, those are all actions. So are you, do you have the ability to take those actions and translate them into line? These are ideas. This is already a checklist of what your job is for the drawing. You see, so awesome, right? So awesome to say, I have ideas that I'm actually after. Very different than looking at a model and copying, right? It's like, it's black and white, extremely two different worlds, right? So be aware of that. I'm really trying to drill into you guys today, just how important it is. I highly recommend writing before you draw, and write nouns before verbs, get the actions down there first, right? And if you have a creative aspect to it, get it down there. You know, judge your drawing at the end on, did I get the creative aspect in there? Does this pose still evoke the same thing I got out of the photograph, right? Did I get to that end?
If I may add something, Mike, the list that you're showing, and especially since you brought up the entertainment industry, like if you're a character designer, let's say, you will get a briefing from the client and, you know, that's the written idea and you have to translate that into a drawing or a sculpture or whatever it is. So, you know, this is great training, at least for me as a character designer. That's been great training, you know, to really learn to interpret ideas and making sure I'm nailing them.
Yeah, you know, I remember years back, when Swenley was a student, right? Like, I remember you were doing a character design of a guy. I can't remember if he was big enough or not big enough, but it was something based on the guy's job. And we were like, oh, the design of him doesn't allow his anatomy to do the job, right? And we were like, oh, we've got to actually change his anatomy, the design of his anatomy, to show that he does this thing. Like, maybe he's a lumberjack or he lifts rocks all day long, right? Certain parts of his body are going to be expressed through that change more than others, right? And that's very real, right? That goes for all of us. Just it's nature, right? Yeah, totally. In fact, you know, nature is probably the best designer, right? Like, you look at a tree and look at the root system pushing down into the ground to grab minerals, right? And energy for the tree. And then it's hard in the middle of it, right? So it's strong. Why is it strong? It's strong to make sure it can get to the top, where it can explode and push out its leaves for photosynthesis, right? To go through this this energy change, right? That it can use to keep it alive, right? It's meant to keep itself alive, right? And it's doing that at the bottom and it's doing it at the top. And those two systems are working hand in hand to keep this tree alive, right? So yeah, I mean, it's really, if you start looking at the world through the concept of function, it's pretty damn amazing, right? And what we're trying to teach you is to get your head in that thinking, right? That the thinking is what drives all of the portraits I showed you today, all the artwork, right? We looked at that student's work from the rendering to the line drawing, because in the rendering, they knew how to copy, right? They knew how to copy that. All of a sudden, line drawing, what am I thinking about? All they were really thinking about was drawing an outline shape of that drawing. That was it. There was nothing else going on yet. So I'm happy they're here with us, right? Because I'm going to help them change that. But that's all it was, right? And here it is. This is what I want you thinking about. Look at this one. Bending, pushing. I love this. Pushing into the left shoulder, stretching, connecting to the tilting pelvis, hanging, sweeping, pushing, rising, supporting, spread, pulling, sliding, bent, flattening, flinging, clenching. I can draw that. You see, I can draw that. That is an awesome list, right? And they inspire me, right? It inspires me to want to do it, right? So it's pretty damn good. All right, running out of time. I want the guys to have a chance to draw. I'm going to close here with just a couple of other student samples. All right, look at this student. This student actually drew the metaphor, right? So they were thinking about this slide of the torso and of the body, and actually drew the slide of the torso of the body right there, right? You can see the legs, and there's a slide. It's pretty ingenious if you think about it. Those of you that ever are going to go into architecture, industrial design, believe it or not, you can use force to help you design. You can even use the figure as inspiration points for something like architecture, cars, you know, slides, whatever it may be, right? So I think it's super creative. Last but not least, I can't remember if I've shown this to you guys or not before, but I think about water running through the body quite a bit. This student took upon themselves to actually paint it in, right? With this little kayaker, right? So we've got this guy going down the river. You can see over the shoulders, you would actually go down a little waterfall to get to the head. I love this moment here in the arm, right? Because we go through this term, come over the arm, hit the elbow, gravity drops us down, right? You'd have a lot of splashing of force down there to finally get out the hands. So to me, drawing is so much more than copying, okay? It is so much more. It is so much more creative, so much more exciting. If it wasn't, I wouldn't have been doing this for almost 30 years now, right? that the reason I can still teach this is because to me it is boundless, right? Boundless opportunity about how creative I can be. Where am I going to push myself? What are my ideas? I love challenging myself with having these crazy ideas and seeing if I can execute them. Like, can I pull this off? Am I going to break something or not? How far can it go? The character design book is probably the best example of that. For those of you that are interested in that, that's the one where I'm really pushing craziness all over the place, okay? All right, so I'm gonna end on that. We haven't talked today. Normally we talk about who's gonna go first. Who went first last week, guys? Do you remember?
I think Mitunja had some slides to show also like you, so maybe.
Yeah, so let's do that. Yeah. Okay, I'm gonna hand it off to you, Mitunja.
All right. So, the thing that we're talking about today, so I thought, you know, let's compare it with my own drawings, you know, with myself, because I've been at that place where I was just like, oh, you know, the realism is like the highest state I want to go. And I just like want to do realism all the time. This is what I was thinking when I started doing like these portraits and stuff. And because of like all the environment that I have, like in India, India is not like very developed in terms of art and everything. So yeah, the more realistic that you can draw is the better artist you are. This is like what the community, art community India thinks. So yeah, I was like growing that place. So the first I was like doing that. So let's start with that. What my old work looks like. And yep, here we go. Yeah, starting from 2016, like, and this is like, I guess this is my second try, like first try maybe. So again, what is this? Like, I was so happy when I drew this. Like, oh my God, you know, I'm able to draw that, you know, just like photograph, you know, I can just like literally take a photograph and I can enlarge it to this size. And my parents were super proud. I was like, oh my God, you're a great artist and everything. So
yeah. So that's a trap. I want to talk about that for a second. That is that's an interesting trap, right? The trap is getting rewarded, right, for photorealism, right? Because people who are not artists think, oh my God, look, you made it real. You're an artist, right? That's amazing. I've been there too, right? And that's a trap. You know, you get stuck in there because you want to be admired for the work versus the abstraction. There's plenty of people on planet Earth that still would look at Picasso and say, I don't get it. What the hell? I don't think he knows what he's doing, right? But you look at his old work, go, oh yeah, I like that better, right? But I think what we all want to share with you is it's actually not as hard to do the copying as it is to do the stuff we're talking about.
Yep. So, you know, the same thing that Mike told you, you get rewarded for it by everyone. And then you're just like growing up and up. Like, you're not growing, it's just like, climbing up that mountain of ego is like, oh, I'm a great artist, you know, I can copy that so well. And at a certain point, like someone told you, it's like, oh, no, you're not that great. I was like, oh, I can like copy the skin details. Look, it was so great, you know, like the skin details and everything, like every wrinkle, you know, like everything.
So how old were you when you did that, do you know?
Yeah, this was drawn in 2016, so about 16, 17 years ago. Like,
yeah, so look, so Mertunje did this as a teenager, okay? Mm-hmm. So think about that. Now, Mertunje is awesome. No discredit to Mertunje, but he did this at 16, 17 and saw this clearly. Do I think this helped him learn force? Yeah, I do, actually. I do think it helped that he had this level of clarity. But he wasn't drawing with, and maybe he could have, who knows, right? Maybe he could have been drawing with force at 16, but he didn't know that yet, right? He was here. This is why I say, I think seeing is really important. I think that's what, one of the things that helped Mertunje actually excel as fast as he did. He had clear sight, unbridled, clear vision. But it's very different to do this than to do what we're talking about here today. To have ideas and execute on ideas, totally different. Go ahead, sorry.
You're really right. You know, I wasn't aware about the structure in there. So, you know, I wasn't aware about the anatomy or like the structure of the face or anything. But this helps me getting into force. It's just like, it develops my observation, basically. So, you know, I was looking at every wrinkle and everything. So it develops my observation, nothing more than that. You know, that's just like literally copying and something like that. So anyway, that's something, you know, here's what how I was doing the figure drawings, you know, at that time. You can see the date in here. It's like 26 April 2018. I also wrote the time in there. So in 2018, I was like, oh, you know, I want to sculpt muscles and everything, like realistic rendering and everything. But again, that's not, yeah, it involves some understanding of muscles and everything, like actually better than before. But again, that's not enough, you know, just to inject my opinion on that. You know, that's not opinion, that's just a photograph that I choose and choose like a small focus for area, like the torso and the neck part, and then just like copying it over. So, yep. Same thing's happening. This is one of the master studies that I did in my college time. Again, this was like 2017. So yeah, just like a lot of copying. So even if it impresses you a lot, that doesn't impresses me. And reason for that is because every painting, every sketch that I did, every drawing that I did is the same experience, okay? You're just like, oh, that's the piece in front of you or the model in front of you. And you're just like copying it for hours and hours. And it's the same experience. You just have to like invest time in it. Okay. The only thing that you need to invest is material and time. Okay. So nothing more than that. The opinion is more about, and what excites me more than anything about like force, I wouldn't even consider force. I would just like say drawing. Okay. That like with every drawing, with every pose, let's say, it brings a new experience for me. Okay. So, well, the model is doing this or the model is doing that, you know, he's like thrusting over like this, or he's like flying like this, or sometimes it's more like rhythmic, it's like poetic, sometimes it's more like ballet-like, or sometimes it's more like a comet-like, you know, like with a lot of energy. So every pose that model gave, even if it's the same model, it doesn't matter, you know, with every pose, it brings like a new experience. It gives me like, it takes me from that mundane process like all over again and again, you know, just like copy the forms, you know, just like doing something like this and like then toning in and then just like completing it to a rendered state. So yep, that's mundane, you know. I still do it, you know, because like clients want it, and I'm happy that I can do it, because you know, from that side I can make my clients happy, but that's not my personal choice anymore. Okay. So yeah, some more drawings, and this is like the eye study. I won't call it a study. It's again, like a copy or something. So even if it's like so great, so good for you, it's not good for me. Okay. Again, in 2018, I did this one, the same thing, you know, it's like, it's, oh my God, you know, you're a good, great artist. All my friends were like, oh my God, you can do this, like teach us, like senpai, teach us and everything, you know, that those kind of things. And I was like so happy with my life, you know, I can like really teach my friends, but it doesn't impresses me anymore. It's like, oh, I don't want to like spend hours and hours on it. Something that I already experienced, you know? So
I was just going to ask you, do you remember how long something like this would take you?
Yeah, it would take me about like a week or something. Again,
like 40 hours or so?
30, 40 hours, yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the same thing. This is, this is like some old work. So let's have a look at the current work. So it's not very current. I just like grabbed like a bunch of them. Okay. Now here comes experience. I was like, here, now I'm able to just like inject my opinion in every pose. I'm not able to just experience like what model is feeling. Is like what Mike is teaching is like utilitarian, okay, and the practical side, right? It's what it's called, right? So
yeah.
I don't know like the terms of these, but the idea was same, you know. So I divide art into like two sides. It's like the emotional side and the practical side of it, things. So practical side involves like all the physical aspects, like maybe the proportions, the anatomy, the measurements, you know, shapes and all those kind of things. But the emotional side of it is really like what you need to bring into your work. It's like, oh, where's that part? You know, nobody's teaching, why nobody's teaching like how to bring that emotional stuff, you know, how to bring the life when you're drawing something live, like a human figure or an animal, okay? Most of the yeah, in my college as well, you know, I'm just like, oh, just go for the proportions, you know, how accurate can be there. But why are you not teaching like how to bring life, you know, when you're drawing something like so dynamic, something like this, okay? So here, you know, look, I'm just like trying to go for my experience, okay? I'm doing something like this. Okay, I'm doing something like this. So I was like, oh, this the energy, look at that energy in the legs, like hitting that ground in there. And you know, that turn, that twist, you know, that torque, how it's like creating that energy inside the figure to make it live. And just like, it's comparable to the painting that Mike, you know, shows us, like the stroke and the brush strokes, the energy in the brush strokes are really what making that painting live. It's like, it feels like emotion. It feels like that painting is not stiff. It's like she's moving a little bit, okay? So this is, you know, what makes my experience better every time, right? So I'm just quickly skimming through every drawing here. So again, the experience, you know, I'm just like going for different experiences and different poses, okay? Sometimes you may see like, oh, I'm focusing on the hands right here, okay? I'm focusing on this one is he's pushing onto the floor, and with the same energy, the floor is pushing up into his shoulder right there, okay? So yeah, it basically involves like the physics and the beauty, okay, like the rhythmic nature of the human body together. I'm trying to like take it over like this. So yeah, look here, you know, that beer is like attacking that another beer. It's like, oh, look at that, you know, that experience. I want to feel like the experience of the beer. I want to be like that beer, you know. I want to live in the skin of the beer and feels like, oh, I'm attacking someone, and how it feels like to be this beer, to be the victim beer. It's like, oh, somebody heavier, like 200 kgs is like on myself, you know, attacking me. So yep, trying to get this. And again, this is one of my current works on it. I post a lot of them on Instagram, and I'm been daily posting there, so you can have a look at many of the drawings there. So yeah, look.
To me, this is an interesting piece because mm-hmm. we're starting to get into a little more rendering, right? There's light and shadow, and so it starts crossing the bridge. But yeah. The difference is, it doesn't feel like a copy to me. This feels like a study, you know, like this is actually showing more thought than just purely a copying, right? The use of the line in here is really showing you all the work that's happening, instead of purely just tone, you know. It's different, it's different space, you know, it's very good.
Yep, so now we can call it a study, finally.
Yeah, yeah.
So, yeah, I uploaded this one like a few days ago, and look, what I'm going for is I'm going for that tightness in the fist. I really want, you know, that hand to feel tight around that bar. It's like, okay. So again, the experience, you know, and you cannot see like the whole hand, by the way. So if you may be like looking at this part of the hand in the drawing, then you may feel like the tightness, but this is more hard, you know, this angle is more hard to feel that, to make the feel that tightness over. So yeah, I was just going for that. Again, now I can finally say to myself, okay, now I'm studying things, okay? I'm bringing the experience, and I'm bringing what actually happening with the subject. And I'm trying to like bring that together and then present it to you. It's like, so you can feel the same thing, okay? Both the things combined. And yeah, again, one more hand, you know? Going for that tightness, you know, how it's like, the tight, if it like shoots you on your face, you'll be like dead. So something like this. So in the end, I don't want to take like too much of Swinley's time here, but look here. You know, she is one of my favorite artists, you know, Jenny Saville. And again, I want to bring like these guys, you know, what we are just sharing today, these guys almost like forget that, forget to be a camera, okay? I just like want to say that don't be a camera, like be yep. an artist, right? Yep. You can be just like, you can take a photograph. Why do you want to like draw it and like spending 50 hours, right? And this is, look here, you know, no camera in the world can capture that, no matter how advanced it becomes, no matter how much filters you apply on it. Look here, you know, nobody can capture that expression that she's bringing over here, okay? So, and she has like a lot of, look here, what she's doing, you know, she's inspired by Rafael. Rafael is her favorite artist, you know, one of her favorite artist, you know, she's inspired by. So she's kind of like, I'm explaining, okay? So you can look at this video on YouTube, by the way, if you want to. Look how big her work is. I really like feel mesmerized with by like, oh my God, look at that awesome, you know, like the big, the painting that she was doing, and like how it feels to be like moving your whole shoulder, like being physical with your artwork, right? That's what the experience for me is, okay?
Yeah,
she's like cool. Moving her whole hand and being physical with her artwork. And yeah, that experience, I really wanted to. I didn't get a chance to do it, but yeah, hopefully in future. And look here, you know, this is the close-up of a line. This is a close-up of a line here. It feels like that drawing is almost moving, okay? It's like an animation frame, like on keeping a kept on light box. And it's like, oh, that foot or that hand is like moving, okay? And you don't feel like the stiffness of the figure, but it's like moving there. So yeah, in the end, I just like, myself, I must say that stop being a camera, okay? Just be an artist, like inject your opinion, draw what you think, okay? That's it.
So leave that up there. I'd like to close on this image. So, Swenley, are you okay with that? Or is there anything you want to add?
No, I would say, I would add, like Mentorji brought up a good point, and to like summarize everything that has been said, especially for those who want to work in entertainment or as illustrators, you know, you're getting paid for ideas, you know, and the skill is just a method or a means to communicate your ideas. But your ideas is what your clients are actually paying you for, you know, and if you're all you're doing is copying, then once there is nothing to copy, then you have a problem, you know. So it's super, super important to make the shift to really analyzing your subject and having ideas, you know, and then you can bring these ideas to your work, you know, and it makes them so much richer and interesting to look at.
Yeah, I think that's spot on. So I'm going to close today with something in between what Mutunji and Swenley said, and that is, you know, the world has enough cameras. We all have a camera in our pocket at this point, right? We don't need another camera in the world. I think what we need more of is individuality, you know, and opinion, creativity that it takes to form those opinions, right? To actually have the courage to say something about the way you see the world, right? I think that's we're all starving for that. We pay for entertainment because there's other people out there that are making creative choices, right? That we pay to actually go watch in TV or go see in a film or see in a gallery, right? Anyone can take a photograph. Is it bad to know how to copy? No, it's not bad to know how to copy. I think it teaches you sensitivity of sight. You learn how to see, but I think it's a very fast dead end, quite honestly. I think that there's much more to art than getting to the photo real image. It's one goal, right? It's one goal. But I think there are goals that are far past that goal that are more demanding, that take more energy and work and creativity to get to. And I hope that we inspired you today to do so. So thank you, Mutunji and Swenley. Awesome talk today. I'm looking forward to seeing what you guys, you know, do in the future, the teachers and you guys that are out there on the in the live chat, you know, post your stuff on Instagram. You know, connect with us out there in the world so we get to see all the great creations that you are making. And we will see you guys next Friday. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, guys.
See you guys.